During the late 1960s and early 70s, one of the most consistently successful bands on the Canadian music scene was Edward Bear. Hit after hit played on the radio and flew out of the record stores. Although the best-known lineup for the band was as a trio, Edward Bear's lead singer Larry Evoy says it didn't start out that way.
It was a five-piece band originally, and then it kept switching with me playing drums because I wanted to be a singer. I just want to stand up and be a singer. And then we'd lose the drummer because drummers are notoriously flaky, even though I'm a drummer. And then I'd play drums, and then finally it got to the point where with the bass player left, we had seen the Doors, and we realized that, you know, a good keyboard player can play bass with his left hand. And Paul was a good keyboard player, so he could do that. And that's what we did, ended up a three-piece band.
Now that they had a band, they still needed a name.
Somebody had given me the book on Winnie the Pooh, and that's the first page. Here comes Edward Bear bumping down the stairs. And we were just trying to get a name. And like idiots, we called it the Edward Bear Revue as a joke, because there were so many R&B bands then, and we were not an R&B band. And we got booked at the Club 888, I think it was called. People flick cigarettes at us. It was like horrible. It was just a bad idea. So we changed it to just Edward Bear.
It was Capitol Records of Canada executive Paul White who signed Edward Bear to the label, but not before Larry checked out a book on how the music business really worked.
I read This Business of Music, which was a music book, just before we signed with Capitol, and figured out, really? You just read the book? Oh, that's how it works. Capitol was being pitched, you know, constantly, trying to, oh, you know, you got to sign this band, this is a good band. We had somebody working for us as a sort of a manager, and trying to get hold of them. And then finally, I think Paul White saw us, I don't know if he remembers this, but he saw us on a TV show. We ended up doing a CBC TV show. And as opposed to actually coming to see us, he saw the show and went, oh yeah, that's the band that keeps bugging me. So they ended up signing us, which was great.
The live Edward Bear sound was much harder than most of their records. And so early on in their career, they were invited to be the opening act for Led Zeppelin at the Rock Pile in downtown Toronto.
I mean, it was exciting, mostly because I can't remember which one it was, but they refused to go on because Rock Pile was withholding tax. And some idiot in the audience stole the distributor cap off their truck, their rented truck. So as a roadie was loading their truck, like he's saying, okay, I'm putting all this away. One guy doing everything for Zeppelin. And then found that they'd stolen the cap. They worked out a deal, but the new deal was, we don't go on until the distributor cap comes back. It comes flying up from the audience. Some guy throws it back to him. Edward Bear as a band started just doing covers of everybody's stuff and then slowly started writing. And the first album was really good because sometimes we'd be rehearsing and I'd bring in lyrics and a melody and they'd be jamming something. Danny and Paul would be playing something that actually perfectly suited it. So it would all fit together, you know, it was kind of like a perfect collaboration where you don't even have to think about it. It just is already there. It just worked really well.
In 1970, Capitol Records released the Edward Bear debut album, Bearings. Right out of the gate, the boys and the Bear had themselves a hit.
It worked for whatever reason. Certainly the early Bear, we were a heavier band. I mean, you can't open for Led Zeppelin unless you're sort of heavier. Yumi in Mexico was a bit of a, it was just strange because it was a single for sure, you know. And Capitol was real excited about that because that's what record companies did. They wanted a single from an album, no matter who you were. But then what changed it completely was adding all the sweetening. You know, when you do something like add trumpets and marimba and everything, that because it was Mexico, you know, it all made sense. But it just completely changed it. I liked it. I thought, wow, that's really impressive. Well, look what they did with that.
Still going nowhere.
Once Edward Bear hit the charts, they then hit the road.
We had some horrible tours. The promoters in Calgary had our bus seized by the sheriff because we wouldn't do one of the gigs they wanted us to do. And those are good times, you know. And we didn't do a ton in the US. We just did mostly, and there you go, because of singles, you end up doing theme parks. You know, you do Six Flags Over Texas, you do Disneyland, and I love those kind of gigs. They're really fun. You know, they give you free tickets. Did you know that? You can actually go on the rides. It's really, yeah. And you go backstage and see everything. It's really good.
Edward Bear's follow-up hit to You, Me, and Mexico was Fly Across the Sea. The inspiration for that song came from Larry's own family.
That was my great aunt. I can't remember the sequence of why I was thinking about her, because my grandparents had said to me, you know, she's still over there and she's not doing well. And, you know, and I started feeling badly, thinking this is really stupid. Somebody I've never even met and I should know, and there's this history of, and, you know, I'm thinking, oh, and I could go over there and this could be all. And then she died, like before I could even, you know, so that was the song.
Masquerade was the next Edward Bear song to climb the singles chart.
That same girl I'd written so many songs about, last song, I mean, on and on. There's like 10 songs I think I wrote about her. And that was the same thing. Our guitar player at the time, Roger, just didn't have a lead for it. He just couldn't get a lead. You know, he just didn't have it in his brain. And Terry Brown said, there's no problem, man. I'll get, you know, and he gets Terry Bush in, who is a session guy. And he just sat down and listened to it once, I swear, listened to it once, and then played that lead. Killer lead, like, you know, makes the song what it is. And then he stops and everybody's like, huh? And then he said, do you want me to double that? Which he actually did too, like play it all the same again, exactly the same, note for note. I mean, come on, who can do that, right?
Then, in 1973, Edward Bear struck the motherlode with another Larry Evoy written hit. Last Song went to number 3 on the U.S. singles chart. In Canada, it was a number 1 smash.
I knew, actually, when I finished writing it, that it was a really good song, like a really special song. There was something magical about it, you know? I think it took Capital a while after it was finished. Finally, Paul, I remember Paul going, okay, yeah, this would be a single, and... But me always believing that it would be a really, really strong, big song. And it was.
This is the last song I'll ever sing for you. You come looking for the light, and it won't be there, but I love you.
After 4 years of hit after hit after hit, Edward Bear's hits stopped. Why is still a mystery.
Maybe you just have a time, you know, like a window for everything, and that was the window for the band or for those songs, or I don't know, just faded away.
So what happened to Larry Evoy after the Bear?
I did a whole bunch of stuff, took Second City classes, just trying different things. The last thing I did was in 2000, they had a big music thing in Ottawa. They got all the old guys, the singers from a lot of the old bands like Lighthouse and St. Peter's, and Ian Thomas was there and me, and that was probably my dream gig. The backup band was killer good. They'd played the song or the clip of the song. You'd do like 40 seconds of your song. They were so exactly accurate. So you get to come on, do 40 seconds of your song and go off. And it was like, yes, this is my kind of gig. The best part about that gig, that was in 2000, was my kids were still young enough, they had never seen me perform. And so they were in front. And what stunned them was people were singing along to Last Song, like all the people in the audience. There was a big, like 100,000 people. And they're singing along to Last Song, and they're kind of going, oh, gee, Dad can actually do something.
In 1978, Larry Evoy released a solo album on Attic Records. For many years, he's also been raising award-winning horses. During the past 3 years, Larry's been recording other artists in his home studio. He continues to hear Edward Bear songs wherever he goes.
It still is surreal. I mean, I'll still be in a store and I'll hear, whoa, that's me. Like the voice is familiar, you know, what is that? And be masquerade or something. It's just unusual to hear. It's a very weird thing where you've done something and created something and now it's where you'd hoped it would be, but you can actually hear it there. It's pretty neat.